Welcome to the Windows Azure Pack Infrastructure as a Service Jumpstart. Thanks for joining us. Over the next 2 days, we're going to be exploring a lot of information about the Windows Azure Pack. We're going to be looking at basically end-to-end how to configure it, how to deploy it, how to run it, and how to operate it, covering a variety of different services that cover our infrastructure components. I'm Simon Perriman, Senior Technical Evangelist, and in this first module, I'm joined by Bradley Bartz. We're going to have rotating speakers throughout the event, and first, I'm just going to cover a few housekeeping things. If you're watching this as a live event, please know that we do have a live chat window, and this is supported by a team of our Windows Azure Pack experts. We have people from the engineering team, people from our field, and even MVP supporting this. So please make sure you take advantage of this opportunity to ask us any questions. You'll also notice at the bottom of the window that we have an interactive poll. We're going to be asking poll questions throughout the event, so please share the feedback. We will announce when they come on, and if you are in full screen mode, you will have to hit escape to minimize and get through that. Now, let's go and take a quick look at our course overview and kind of see what we're going to be covering over these next 2 days. We're going to start off by doing an introduction to the Windows Azure Pack. We're basically going to kind of explain the background, the philosophy, the kind of the key design principles behind it. That's going to be a quick module. Then we're going to get more technical and actually look at the installation and configuration. We're then going to look at fabric management and then how to deliver self-service. When we return on our second day, we're going to take a look at automation using the SMA feature, some third-party integration to see how we can extend it and take advantage of other capabilities. And finally, we're going to take a look at creating some tenant experiences. So really how to optimize this new self-service portal for our end users. I'm Simon Perriman, a senior technical evangelist with Microsoft. I've been here about 7 years, spending about half of my time on the Windows Server engineering team and about half my time as the evangelist covering System Center, and now expanded to Windows Azure Pack. I'd now like to introduce Brad. He's going to be our second speaker. Brad, why don't you introduce yourself?
Yeah, I'm Bradley Bartz. I'm the Group Program Manager for the Windows Azure Pack. And I'm on the engineering team, so we're the team that actually builds the product. And I've been with Microsoft about 16 years now, worked in Visual Studio and in the cloud tooling space, and now on Windows Azure Pack. And today we're going to go into a lot of the capabilities that are part of Windows Azure Pack and how we developed it, what principles we had, what were we thinking of, and how does this relate to the Cloud OS vision. So today we'll talk a little bit about that Cloud OS vision, our innovation in the cloud. We'll talk about the customer needs we took into consideration as we were building it. And we'll also look at the Microsoft Azure technologies in your data center and Windows Azure Pack value proposition.
So what is the Cloud OS vision?
Yeah, that's a great question. So let's start with that. The Cloud OS vision is really this transformation as we look at, remember, Microsoft's strategy is really about a cloud-first, mobile-first world. And cloud-first, when we think about that, obviously we have our Microsoft Azure property and our public cloud. And this is really a transformational engineering exercise as we start to design software for the cloud that is designed to scale, that is designed to handle a large number of users. And Azure itself is designed for hyperscale across the globe. In this transformation, we also are looking at the technologies that we deploy into partner data centers. And this is our Windows Server and our System Center technologies and the evolution of cloud in the enterprise and in our hosting providers. And how can we bring those together? That's Cloud OS. Cloud OS is really the Microsoft cloud solution that we operate in our public cloud offering called Azure and that our partners can operate in their data centers, whether it be the enterprise or a hosting provider. And it really is to enable mobility, a great user experience from anywhere on any device, apps that can be deployed both in Azure public cloud and in the private or hosted cloud, big data that could be analyzed across cloud environments. It really is about providing this cloud for on-demand scale, real-time performance, infrastructure designed to withstand failure, resource managed at data center scale. That is Cloud OS.
Now, when we talk about the Cloud OS, we should also be clear, we're not actually talking about a new version of the operating system. We're really talking about this convergence of three different technologies, our Windows Azure Cloud, our System Center Data Center Management, and then Core Windows Server as our key infrastructure management solution. Now, you mentioned that we had three different clouds, right? You said that you can run applications in Azure with a service provider on-premise. Can you kind of talk about this consistency?
You bet. So as part of the CloudOS vision, it became very clear that we needed to have a consistent platform, a platform that we, Microsoft, could offer in our public cloud, but our customers could deploy and our service providers. And really, this is to enable that app mobility so that as an application developer, I can target the cloud regardless of the operator. So I can target the cloud for deployment into Microsoft Azure. I can build an application, that same application, and target deployment within the enterprise or even to a third-party host or to a service provider to enable this modern business applications that can be deployed anywhere, empower this people-centric IT, unlocking insights on any data and this transformation of the data center. So as we looked at this, this CloudOS vision is, in fact, a journey. What we're doing is we're doing a transformation of our technologies to bring together this consistent platform. If you look, they kind of have very different origins. Azure started out as being designed for hyperscale at massive data centers that scale the globe. Windows Server and System Center started really about providing a great operational model for IT administrators within the enterprise and in hosting service providers so that they could manage fabric. And so now what we're doing is we're blending these technologies together so that the operator can actually manage a cloud that can provide the same kinds of capabilities that we, Microsoft, offer, but that the IT administrator and the hosting provider can now offer to their customers. So we're blending Azure technologies and our server and Windows System Center technologies together to create a cohesive, consistent platform. And this will take time. And this Windows Azure Pack release that we have right now is really our first installment on this journey of consistency across our cloud environments.
And I think, you know, one thing to kind of add to this idea of consistency, think about your end users here. Think about the application. Because at the end of the day, your end users don't care where that application is running, right? It could be running in your data center. It could be running with a third-party hoster. It could be running up in Windows Azure. So that level of consistency that your customers expect, that's what we now hope to deliver on the back end and give you that kind of same consistent experience as an administrator as well. Now, let's actually take a quick look at some of the background into how did we really get to this concept of Windows Azure Pack. And you're really going to see that this was built out a lot of our experience with Microsoft Azure's cloud platform itself. Now, Microsoft Cloud isn't just Azure. It's actually a lot of enterprise services that we've been running. If we could jump back to the presentation here, you could see some of these ones that you probably use yourself. Outlook.com has over 300 million user mailboxes. Xbox Live, over 40 million active user accounts. Bing gets billions of search queries every single month. This is real cloud scale. We've actually taken these best practices from running these massive services, taken the key technology, the key learning, put that inside Azure, put that inside System Center, put that inside Windows Server. And so our goal here is to give you some confidence that you can run these massive cloud services with massive scale yourself, because we've done it, we've worked through the best practices, and we're now offering this learning over to you. Now, let's talk a little bit more about innovation in the cloud as well. How do we actually get there? What are kind of the key components of System Center to enable this cloud vision? Now, what we're trying to do with System Center is we're really trying to think about two consumers of our IT resources. You have the IT administrator, you guys, and then we also have the customers, which are our end users. Now, this customer, it could be somebody that's in the public, right? Someone that's just using your service. It could be an internal customer like your SQL database administrator. It could be a non-technical internal customer like someone from human resources. Whatever it is, we want to be able to support this variety of customers. And the very first step that we want to do when thinking about System Center and offering this is self-service. And you're going to see where Windows Azure Pack connects to this shortly. Essentially, what we do with self-service is we provide a clear framework, a set of parameters, and ask people to go and answer questions for us. And this essentially builds a service model. So think of this as almost like going to a restaurant where you have a menu. You open the menu, you have a dozen choices, you can pick one of those items, that's like a self-service portal, and then you get to enter additional information to go and customize it. So when you go and present these self-service options to your end users, we want you to just kind of think of it as a limited set of options, but yet give them customizable capabilities behind that. Now, once we've gone and built out that service model, we're going to then provide automation as kind of the next key step. Now, automation allows us to speed up this deployment, and it also allows us to remove human intervention. So if we have a SQL database administrator that needs to scale out more virtual machines to support more traffic, Let's not add a human in the way to interfere with that. Let's provide that SQL admin a website where they can go in and say, hey, I need to go deploy a new virtual machine, a new VM role. I want to go scale out. And we want to be able to support that automatically as well. Now, when we actually go and provision this service, we also want to be able to provision it across these three different clouds. So if you look at our system center model here, you can see that we're now supporting, of course, the Microsoft public cloud, our customer cloud, your own data center, as well as these third-party service provider clouds. But now, once we've got this new VM or this new service up and running, we got to kind of end the loop here. We can't just deploy it and forget about it. We want to make sure that we're constantly monitoring it, not just for health, whether it's online or not, but also for performance, ensuring that it's reliable, ensuring that your end users get that level of experience that you're expecting, no matter where they're located around the world. And now, as we kind of look at these different pieces, this is where System Center fits in, provided self-service with App Controller Service Manager, and now Windows Azure Pack, providing IT service management with Orchestrator and Service Manager, and then other types of infrastructure operations, from deployment through VMM, monitoring with Operations Manager, securing with Configuration Manager, and backup and restoration with Data Protection Manager. Now, as we kind of put all these pieces together with System Center 2012 R2, we really try to break it down across these five different categories, where we want to think about being able to provision the infrastructure, monitor that infrastructure, provide this automation and self-service to free up your time, better enable our end users, to constantly monitor the health of the VMs and the applications running within them, and then providing standard IT service delivery through traditional models like the ITIL library, the IT infrastructure library. Now, as we look at all these pieces together, one of the questions that always comes up is what exactly is required for Windows Azure Pack? So could you actually give us an overview? What of these System Center or Windows Server or Microsoft Azure components do we actually need for WAP?
Yeah, you bet. So Windows Azure Pack, really at its root, at its core, can even be deployed without System Center. But you have a limited capability. Azure Pack, remember, as a technology, is designed where you can have additional capabilities added to it over time. So in and of itself, Windows Azure Pack supports the management Azure Management Console for deployment in the private data center. And then it has these PaaS services like the Azure Websites runtime that can be deployed. That can run as a self-contained unit, but you would get no IaaS. You would have no VMs. You would have no provisioning of virtual machines. If you actually want to have an IaaS experience plugged into the Windows Azure Pack, then you would need VMM, the Virtual Machine Manager. But in addition to VMM, you'd also need to deploy SPF, the Service Provider Foundation. And SPF is this REST API to VMM that allows Windows Azure Pack to basically manage and provision the VMs on top of Virtual Machine Manager. So you'd need at least VMM with SPF. Now, if you would like to also get into orchestration, or you'd want to be able to have the service management automation capabilities to add customization or custom events that need to happen during the provision process, then you would need SMA deployed, and it also plugs into Windows Azure Pack. In addition to that, we also have other solutions from partners such as GridPro, who's created basically an interface or a plugin to Windows Azure Pack on top of Service Manager for ticketing solutions and service provisioning. So that if you want that kind of capability, then you would need Service Manager as well. So you can kind of piece together the solution you need for your environment based on your specific needs.
That's great. Now let's actually move on and talk a little bit about the customer needs. You know, as we were kind of working on the design, we actually started working on this several years ago, Windows Azure Pack. It's, even though a lot of people think it's brand new, the concept has been around for a while. So we put a lot of engineering resources into thinking about what do the enterprise want? What do our self-service providers want? And so can you kind of talk a little bit more about what these customer needs are and what we tried to accomplish with Azure Pack?
You bet. As we looked at the customer needs, one of the things we took into account is cloud specific to each segment? Or what is the union, the intersection between hosting providers? For example, do they need a different cloud or enterprises? And at the end of the day, there is this desire to have a self-service customer experience for cloud. So here's what we looked at. We looked at enterprises. We found that they want a flexible cloud choice, familiar technologies with no vendor lock-in. They want their own multi-tenanted cloud that is easy to Azure, because many enterprises are already dealing with It goes by many names, but think of it as rogue IT, where they have customers that are going bypassing IT and getting their services from other cloud providers. And so they want to be able to provide that easy self-service model to their customers to rail in or bring in that kind of rogue IT. They also want to enable a chargeback model where they can start doing a usage-based charging for what resources are being used from their data center. They want simple automated operations, more efficient utilization of existing hardware assets, tenant choice and dynamic control, commodity and custom cloud offerings, integration with their line of business applications. When we looked at hosting service providers, we found that, hey, they want to, one, win more enterprises. They actually go out and target enterprise customers as their customers. They also want a multi-tenanted self-service experience for IaaS, but also for PaaS offerings. They want to bring these cloud PaaS offerings to their customers. They want usage-based billing. Instead of fixed-price billing, they want to go into capacity-based billing. Automation is king. They want to automate everything, and they want to optimize hardware monetization. They want opportunities to upsell, increase customer usage. They want to customize offerings between the public cloud differentiation and have tailored offerings for different segments. And they want kind of portal integration and branding with their other offerings today. You can merge these together and find a set of common requirements, and that's what we did. And the common requirements are one, enterprise-friendly, frictionless cloud, multi-tenanted for IaaS based on the Azure experience that we're building, usage-based billing, automation, maximize hardware utilization, tenant choice, offer management, and portal integration and branding are a set of common requirements we saw through that.
So a lot of people say, is this actually Microsoft Azure running in our data center? Can you kind of break down what's Microsoft Azure, how we essentially built this technology, and does that deliver the same set of features as Microsoft Azure?
Sure, you bet. And the question is, how much of Azure is this really?
Yeah.
When we get into that. And so what you're seeing right now is the management portal that's included with the Windows Azure Pack is actually the same code base that we operate in Azure Public Cloud. The REST APIs, the management infrastructure, if you will, is really from the same code base that we operate 24/7 in our public cloud is what we're providing into our partner data centers. Then you get into the set of services. And when I talk about services, I'll break it down into both Fabric and a set of PaaS services. So for example, the Azure Websites Runtime, that's this PaaS runtime for doing a web application. It is actually the same runtime that we deploy in Azure. When you go to Azure and you go to the Azure Websites capability and you deploy a website and you scale it out, that is the same runtime that we include in Windows Azure Pack. When you get into Fabric, now things are a little bit different because Azure is designed for hyperscale, whereas in the partner data center, it's a Fabric provided by Windows Server and System Center designed with greater manageability tools that we offer through System Center and Windows Server. If we think about how we manage the cloud in Azure for hyperscale, we actually have a very sophisticated management system, a lot of PowerShell scripts and teams that are constantly monitoring and managing this really at a global scale. We have a great set of tools in our partner data centers today called Windows Server and System Center. So what we're doing now is blending that Fabric technologies. And over time, you'll see a greater convergence of that Fabric for private cloud, hosted cloud, and in Azure. So that's where you're seeing the convergence between those technologies. But what I'd like to talk about real quickly is what is the Azure Pack? So let's do that. And this is showing a picture right now of the Azure technology that we operate in Azure. We have customers that come in. There's a management portal, a set of workloads or services that we run in the public cloud that's all based on compute, storage, and networking called Microsoft Azure. And Microsoft IT, our own IT organization in Azure, runs that Fabric. And that's the team I was just referring to. So let's take a look at how we decided to deliver this technology into our partner data centers. One, we wanted to make sure that customers would have the same great experience, whether they're going to the IT cloud, or whether they're going to the hosting provider, or even to Azure Public Cloud. So here we brought that tenant portal and API into Windows Azure Pack into the private cloud. Then we have the set of workloads that run on it. Now here's what's different. Those workloads are actually running on System Center and Windows Server, which is providing the compute, storage, and networking. So the Fabric is actually System Center and Windows Server. The benefit of that is you're getting to take advantage of the great manageability tools in System Center and Windows Server, whether you're doing Fabric management, configuration, supporting a variety of hardware topologies, whether you're having to do in-guest management or automation, those capabilities are all layered into the Windows Server System Center value proposition. But on top of that fabric, we now start layering in the Azure capabilities. We had to go one step farther, though. In addition to providing those consistent tenant experiences, we had to provide an administrator. Think of this as kind of the idea of how you go from being a fabric admin to being a service admin. How do I go about packaging services together to create differentiated offers for different sets of tenants coming in? And we have a tenant portal for the IT administrator where they can basically add new custom cloud resources. They can do the automation, the billing, the tenant management, and create these hosting plans that they extend to their customers. This layer across there between tenant and admin portal really represent the Windows Azure pack. Notice that layer ships on top of the Windows Server and System Center. It's not a replacement. It's not an alternative. And by the way, it's worth noting, you can have your existing workloads running on Windows Server System Center as is, deploy Windows Azure pack, and create adjunct offers without disrupting workloads that you're already running on your fabric. Not everything you do on Windows Server and System Center has to be exposed through Windows Azure pack. You can deploy it and create additional offers for other audience segments within your organization. And at the end of the day, it's about delivering these customer-ready services to your customers. Just like we, Microsoft, create customer-ready services that we offer in the public cloud, it's about providing those customer-ready services to your customers and enabling our partners to do that within their data center. So what I'd like to do, because we've kind of gone through a lot of slides and given you a lot of information, I think it would be really good to actually show a demo of this in production so you can see what do we mean by Cloud OS and one consistent platform. What does that look like really? So let's go ahead and do a demo.
Now, while you switch over, I do want to encourage everybody to go and complete our poll. So the first poll question that we're going to be asking is, what is your level of Windows Azure Pack experience? Are you a beginner, intermediate, or expert? And I think we have four or five different options here. And it looks like we've already got some data coming in here from the first 500 or so people that have answered. And we're about 70% a beginner, brand new. About 20% have some experience, 5% intermediate, and then kind of trickling down after that. So it looks like we got a pretty new crew. So we'll definitely cover everything end to end because this is the right course for you. This is the main Windows Azure Pack course. Back to you for the demo.
All right, let's do it. So when we talk about our Cloud OS vision and one consistent platform, I'm actually going to start out by demoing an experience in Microsoft Azure. So I'm going to go ahead and log into Azure. So when I click this link, I'm logging in to Azure, but notice right now I'm logging into Azure with my Microsoft corporate credentials. And this is key because Azure supports organizational identities so that organizations can bring their corporate identities into the public cloud. So here I'm going to log in with my Microsoft credentials. Okay, so I'm logging in, and what this is doing is actually authenticating against the Microsoft corporate AD Forest, generating a claim. That claim is being passed back into Microsoft Azure as an authenticated claim, giving me access to the set of subscriptions that I am authorized to use in the public cloud. And here you see the Azure portal. So now I'm logged into Azure. These are the set of resources that I can manage in Azure. And you notice there's a very long list of resources that are available to me in Azure. For this demo, I'm going to go ahead and do this website. This is that PaaS runtime for a web workload. And I'm just going to create a brand new website. So I'm going to do a quick create of a website. We'll go ahead and create this in, we'll create this in West. And I'll call this demo web 44. How about that? Okay, I'm going to create a new website, and I'm going to go ahead and provision it. Now, what's unique? Because this is a PaaS service, this is actually spinning up unique VMs for me. It's actually provisioning a tenant within the PaaS runtime. You'll notice already done. It is now available and ready for use by me, the application developer. And you notice in Azure provides a lot of capabilities, including integrating, setting up source code control. And what this, as a PaaS runtime, it supports different forms of source code control systems that can be deployed for my application in the cloud. In this case, I'm going to set up a Git repository for my application in the cloud. And this is actually the PaaS runtime doing that. It's creating the Git repository. It's already done and available. So now I've got a Git repository for the web application that I've just created in Azure. I'm going to copy the publishing address for the Git repository in Azure. Now on my local disk, I actually have a Git enlistment of a project I've been developing with some other team members. Now I'm going to push the information from my local enlistment up into Azure public clouds. The first thing I need to do is register that remote connection in Azure. So I'm going to do git remote add, I'll just call it Azure, and I'll paste in that address I got from the Git repository in Azure. Now that I've added that connection, I'm now going to push the information from my local enlistment up into the public cloud. What I'm saying is push into Azure the tip or master enlistment. I'm now being asked to provide my credentials. So I provide those credentials and it should start the publishing process. And that's what's happening right now. And it's worth noting, this isn't like a Microsoft version of Git. It's not a unique version. This is the straight Git from GitHub. Anybody can download it for Linux or Windows and use it in your development environment. In this case, I'm running it from Windows and it's doing the deployment. Notice that Azure is responding in real time. It's getting an active deployment. You can see it's running the deployment commands in the public cloud for my local enlistment. Matter of fact, it's already done. The deployment has completed. You'll notice I have a complete version history in Azure for all the publishing actions that just occurred. Just to verify that the action did occur, I'm going to hit a browse to browse the application that I just deployed in Azure. And there it is. The application is up and running in the public cloud. Now, you've just seen kind of a web publishing story, but we've been doing web publishing for years. What makes it different about being in the cloud? It really is about manageability and scale. Part of being in the cloud allows me to scale my application. In Azure, we allow you to have a variety of different SLAs. I can be running in free, shared, in basic. And when you go between these different SLA models, I'll be offered different capabilities, such as, oh, do I want this to run on small, medium, or large? Compute sizes. When I pick that size, I can also scale my application from one instance to two instances, up to three instances in Azure, depending on the plan. So now what happens, if I were to commit those changes, my application would already be running at scale to the parameters I've defined. I don't need to redeploy the application. This is what makes it cloud. This dynamic, this configurable cloud elasticity for my application that I've deployed in the cloud, and that is unique. Okay, so now that you've just seen a demonstration in Azure, let's talk about Windows Azure Pack. I'm just going to close this. Now I'm going to log in.
And now, while you go through that, I'm going to answer one of the most common questions that we're starting to see through the live chat here. Windows Azure obviously requires an internet connection. Does Windows Azure Pack actually need to have an internet connection up to Windows Azure or anything like that? Microsoft Azure. And the answer to that is actually no. You can run this entirely isolated in your data center. You know, we had a lot of customers, large government customers, for example, that didn't trust or for whatever regulatory or compliance reasons could not go and actually put that up there. But so Windows Azure Pack, it can be fully isolated.
That's exactly right. It can be deployed in a completely isolated private cloud without any internet connectivity. All right, so now you've just seen an experience in Azure. I'm now going to log into a private cloud. But this private cloud, so I'm going to click the Windows Azure Pack link, and you're going now to a Windows Azure Pack deployment. Now, Windows Azure Pack, what makes it different than Azure is that it can be configured to the unique requirements of any given organization. And one of those requirements is, who's my user authenticating provider? Where do I get my identities from? It can either be a built-in identity provider or an AD forest or a custom STS provider. In this case, we've configured this deployment of WAP to use the same Microsoft IT identity. So I'm going to log in against an ADFS node that is operated by the Microsoft IT so I can log in with my corporate credentials. So here I'm going to go ahead and do that, just like I did in Azure.
Now, we had another question come up here. Is there a dependency on Active Directory?
Okay, there is not. Matter of fact, basically the dependency is, this is a cloud about providing cloud access to your customer. So really, it's a claims-based access model. So what we need is an STS claims provider. That claims provider can be any, for example, you could be using Ping for federated identities. You could be using ACS from Azure if you want. You can be using ADFS. Or, for example, our integration with Parallels allows you to use the Parallels STS provider as the identity provider. So what we really need is a claims provider for your identity source. Okay, so now I'm logged in to the Windows Azure Pack private cloud, but notice I'm logged in with my corporate, my Microsoft identity. So here I'm logged in. You'll see I have a list of services on the left. This list of services is actually a smaller list than what you saw in Azure, but it is also configurable based on what I have access to through my subscription. So this is what we call an adaptive or dynamic UI. It is only showing me the set of services that I can access. So in this case, I'm going to go through the same demo that you just saw in Azure. I'm going to go create a brand new website, just like I did. I'm going to do a quick create of a website. Demo, web, I think I called it 44, doesn't really matter. Go ahead and create that site. Now, just like I did in Azure, it's going to go ahead and provision this against that PaaS runtime. And it's not spinning up VMs, it's actually provisioning a tenant on that PaaS service. You'll notice again that it's also already done. Just like in Azure, I have a number of configuration options, including setting up source code control. So I'm going to go ahead and go through the same process I just did in Azure and set up a Git repository for my application in the private cloud. I now have a publishing endpoint for it. I'm going to copy that publishing endpoint. I'm going to go back to the same enlistment that I just pushed up into Azure. I'm not going to a different project. This isn't a different private cloud version of the application. Same application. You just saw me push into Azure, but now I'm going to register the Windows Azure Pack publishing endpoint that was just created for me. I'll call this one WAP, and I'll paste in that endpoint. So I've now got it in there, and now I'm going to do that same action to push into WAP the master. So this is pushing into there the same thing. I have to provide my publishing credentials. I provide the credentials again, and we start the publishing process. And again, the key thing I want you to know here, as a web developer, this is what we mean by a consistent platform. You'll notice there is no difference whether I was targeting the Microsoft public cloud or whether I'm targeting the IT-operated cloud or whether I'm targeting a service provider cloud. As far as an application developer building web applications, I'm using the same tools. I'm using the same experience. I have the same capabilities regardless of the operator I'm getting the cloud service from. Notice that just like in Azure, it was recognizing an active deployment. Just like in Azure, I've got a complete version history. And just like Azure, if I were to browse the application, we'll see the application up and running in the private cloud, just like it was in the public cloud. But this is about a cloud application, that is all. Do I still get the same scaling capabilities? You do. When I go to scale, you'll notice I have different SLAs. What's a little bit different about the Windows Azure Pack configuration for the private data center is that the IT operator can define what these different tiers of service, whether I'm doing intro, basic, or reserved, mean. They can decide when you go into reserved instances, for example, what the compute size for small, medium, and large in, and they can define whether I can scale my application or not. That's called a hosting plan, and you'll get to learn more about hosting plans in later sessions today. But you'll notice that I can still scale the number of instances for my application just like I did in Azure, so I'm getting the benefits of cloud, but I'm getting that in the private data center or the hosted data center. So what you're seeing is that is a consistent platform for the cloud solution, both in Azure and in the private hosted cloud. And that's really the extent of our demo today.
Great. So I guess that kind of wraps up the first section here. You know, just kind of to review here, I think kind of the key messages are Windows Azure Pack, run it in your own data center, right? Other
Absolutely.
Key learnings, lots of Azure technologies built in. We've been running them at scale for a long time. But what are kind of the other key points here that we want to remind people of?
One, this is really defined for enterprise class workloads. It is ready for production workloads in your data center. It builds on the foundation of Windows Server and System Center. So by itself, it's not a solution. It is additive. It adds value to Windows Server and System Center. It provides this rich self-service experience for your customers. It helps you maximize the utilization of resources within your environment. For example, you can do multiple cloud deployments, whether you have a cloud running on commodity hardware for those kind of agile projects that are going on within your organization, or you can also have a cloud on production hardware with big iron that you're using for applications that need to be in production for 24/7 operation. So it's very configurable, and that's the key, and it can run in a completely isolated manner inside the private cloud, completely decoupled from the internet, but it can also be hosted and give access to external customers coming into your cloud if you choose to configure it that way.
All right, well, that's actually going to wrap up our first module here. We want to remind you of a few resources that we have here. Download these products from the TechNet Evaluation Center, try hands-on with the TechNet Virtual Labs, and of course, come back to the Microsoft Virtual Academy, where you'll get live and on-demand training for this and a whole bunch of other technologies. We're now going to go and take a 10-minute break. After we return, I'm going to be joined by another guest, and we're actually going to be looking at how we install and configure the Windows Azure Pack. We'll be right back.